Hi, let's talk about blood. Blood is a solution that comprises approximately 8% of our body's mass. As a solution, blood has two major constituents. There's the blood plasma, which is about 55% of the total mass of the solution. And then there are the formed elements, which comprise about 45% or the remaining total of blood. Within the blood plasma, water accounts for about 92% of its volume. The remainder includes a number of proteins and other dissolved solutes within the blood. The plasma would appear to the casual user as a clear fluid, and contained within that plasma would be the formed elements. The formed elements are cells or parts of cells that have distinct functions. And they include erythrocytes, or red blood cells, leukocytes, or white blood cells, and thrombocytes, or platelets. The red blood cells are of supreme importance in terms of gas delivery, such as oxygen and carbon dioxide. The white blood cells are an important component of the immune system, and they all play various roles in that. And the platelets are important for modulating clotting of blood. Here we can see a typical field of view of a histologist who is looking at a blood slide. And within this field of view, we can see all of the major formed elements of the blood. We can see the erythrocytes, which look like biconcave discs. We can see the leukocytes in their various appearances. And we can also see thrombocytes floating around in the solution as well. The formed elements are all ultimately derived from pluripotent stem cells that arise from the mesoderm, or the middle layer of the trilaminar embryonic disc. You can see here that these pluripotent stem cells are capable of becoming either myeloid stem cells or lymphoid stem cells. Each of these cells has a high degree of potency, meaning that they're capable of giving rise to many different lineages of cells. And as they move through their own development, they're going to lose that potency, such that their options for what they may become are rather limited. We can see that myeloid stem cells, for example, can give rise to colony-forming unit erythrocytes or colony-forming unit megakaryoblasts, which give rise to pro-erythroblasts and megakaryoblasts, respectively, which ultimately give rise to either erythrocytes or thrombocytes. Also derived from myeloid stem cells are mast cells, which are an important and sometimes annoying component of the immune system because they secrete histamine, that substance that makes us itch. And also derived from myeloid stem cells are colony-forming units that will give rise to a number of different granular leukocytes. These are white blood cells that contain within them tiny little granules that they can release into the environment. And they are basophils, neutrophils and eosinophils. I always remember this as my good friend, Ben, B-E-N, basophil, eosinophil, neutrophil. In addition to these, this cell line can also give rise to monoblasts, which develop into monocytes that in tissues are macrophages. Macrophages are an interesting complement to the immune system because they can engulf pathogens, digest them from within, and then they can stick parts of them on their outer cell plasma membrane so that they can be presented to the immune system. The other pathway that these pluripotent stem cells from mesoderm can follow is the route of the lymphoid stem cell. And the active word here is lymphoid. So lymphoid stem cells are going to give rise to lymphoblasts, which give rise to lymphocytes. So a blast is an immature mesodermal derivative, and a site is a mature mesodermal derivative. And the three important cells here are going to be T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes, and natural killer cells. Two of the three of these, the T and the B lymphocytes, are of importance for adaptive immunity. Finally, within the blood, we have a number of mechanisms to help the body achieve homeostasis. If you were to sample the pH, which is a measure of acidity or alkalinity of the blood, of the interstitial tissues, of any fluid of the body that's very general, you would find that it's between 7.35 to 7.45. This is what we would dub as physiologically neutral, even though on the absolute pH scale, which runs from 0 to 14, 7 is neutral, and the range of 7.35 to 7.45 would actually be somewhat basic. So the enzymes of our blood are optimized to work in this range of 7.35 to 7.45. If we go below 7.35 for an extended period of time, this is a condition known as acidemia. This can be harmful or even fatal. Likewise, if we go above 7.45 for any real amount of time, this is a condition known as alkalemia, and this can be harmful or even fatal. And so your blood contains a mechanism called the carbonic acid bicarbonate ion buffer system. And what this is an opportunity to resist changes of pH such that we can stay close to the limits of 7.35 to 7.45. And what's most important is that this system, while it works within the blood and even within a red blood cell, it can also work in concert with other organs. And so this as a concept is what's going to allow us to tie together these lessons about the cardiovascular system and the respiratory system and the renal system. So let's explore how that might happen. Here in the center of the equation is carbonic acid. Carbonic acid is in a dynamic equilibrium in two directions. One direction with bicarbonate ion and a proton. The other direction with carbon dioxide and water. And each of these directions is going to be meaningful with respect to different systems. So for instance, if the body is experiencing acidemia, and that would be a blood pH of below 7.35, there would be an excess of protons, and through Le Chatelier's principle, this equation would shift left. And ultimately, more carbon dioxide and water would be produced. That excess carbon dioxide can be gotten rid of by means of the lungs or through respiratory compensation. Conversely, if blood pH is elevated, that's alkalemia, the equation can shift to the right. And bicarbonate or protons can be eliminated, or depending on the conditions, conserved in the nephrons of the kidneys. And so this is a rather complex, yet at the same time, elegant solution to being able to maintain a range of pH that's important for the proteins of the blood. And it involves the cardiovascular system, the respiratory system, and the urinary system. So we've seen how the blood is put together, and we see what the major players are of the blood. In subsequent lessons, we'll explore the peculiarities of these formed elements, and we'll examine them at a greater detail and at a greater scope of function. Thank you very much.